bills are HJ 661, House Bill 2467, House Bill 2468, and HJ 643. So I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Okay, so that's a vote, so Ms. Reichman, docket. By a vote of 5-0, they've been stricken from the docket. Okay. Next items of business that we have is we'll start with the Crime Commission, Block 2, HJ 614. Delegate Delaney on the Crime Commission. The Crime Commission, we're not going to send bills to the Crime Commission legislatively. We're going to ask the patron to ask the Crime Commission, do they have room and do they view it as a priority? And we have legislative members on the Crime Commission, so that's what we're going to do. So I would ask, knowing that, for a motion to table HJ 614.
So moved.
Okay. So, please cast your vote. By a vote of 6-0, that motion's been laid on the table. We'll ask her to go and ask the Crime Commission, which is a legislative commission, they can see that, do that. I have also on Block 1, our JLARC bills, and I'm going to name the bills, and I'm going to ask Delegate Landis to give us a short explanation on what we're doing here. We have HJ 609 Carter, HJ 621 O'Quinn, HJ 629 Heretic, HJ 624 Watts, HJ 645 Kratis, HJ 660 Poindexter, HJ 673 Rome, and HJ 681 Byron. And that's a legislative committee also, but Delegate Landis, do you want to explain to the folks here why we're doing this?
Well, Mr. Chairman, just so the folks in that block understand, the Joint Legislative Audit and Review Commission, I have the honor of serving as Vice Chairman now. About a year and a half ago, the commission now has a standing subcommittee responsible for taking all recommendations for studies for JLARC to accomplish. And they work with staff and try to prioritize those based on the workload. So what we're doing by this motion, Mr. Chairman, is suggesting that those be communicated to the JLARC staff and in preparation for the subcommittee when it next meets, which will be Tuesday, August or September, in preparation for the next year's work, that all these be considered, and then that standing subcommittee of JLARC would make a recommendation on which ones would and wouldn't be considered. Just like any meeting of JLARC, that meeting is public and open. We have discussions, and people could, at that point, if they want to, make their case why certain studies should be considered. But Mr. Chairman, the reason we brought that about is because JLARC gets so many recommendations, there's only enough time for the staff to work on things on a yearly basis that we started to try to keep things up. Now, it does take a year or two sometimes before those items get into the queue, but most importantly, it's more organized, and it's a fair way to consider all these recommendations.
Thank you. Chair will entertain a motion to lay on the table.
So moved.
Okay. Please cast your vote. So by a vote of 6-0, those bills have been laid on the table. Okay, we're going to go down this list, and what we're going to do today is each side, we have had a total of 63. You all can kind of do the math on the amount of time it would take. So what we're going to do is we've got a timer here. It's going to be 3 minutes when the patron starts to explain his bill to the time that the proponents are done, and then we'll have the opponents, and then we'll have a vote on the measure. So if you're patron of a bill, when you have someone that wants to speak to the manager, you think is more knowledgeable than you, you better be cognizant of your time. So, is Delegate Robinson here?
Yep.
Okay. We have House Bill 1735.
Can you basically tell us what you moved those, or did you just tell us?
No, I didn't say yet. Okay. So I've run the straight line 47 on the bill. It just kind of generic, let's say members of the commission shall receive such compensation provided by exception of the code. And rather than that, it just goes into language that is more explicit on that compensation.
All in favor of the amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. The bill is amended just before us. Let's see, is there anyone here who would like to speak opposing this measure? It was a recommendation of the Safety Select Committee. Bill 1847.
Virginia opportunity for all.
Okay, thank you. Anyone here to speak in favor of this measure?
Yes, sir.
My name is Melissa, the Virginia Nurses Association, I'm the board of directors. We support this bill because we believe that every Virginian deserves the opportunity to live in a state of well-being and have access to safe and affordable healthcare. In order to ensure that this happens, the optimal health of our citizens and communities, we must ensure that wellness is factored into the decisions related to education, employment, housing, transportation, land use, economic development, and public safety. We must work alongside community and government partners to support legislative solutions that promote a culture of health and tackle the population health issues highlighted in Virginia's well-being plan to address the health disparities that were identified and that need to be corrected. The Virginia Nurses Association supports the establishment of a commission on wellness and opportunity to help facilitate this work. Thank you.
Thank you. Is anyone here in opposition to this measure? Okay, committee, what's your pleasure?
Move report.
Treasure dies for lack of a second.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. Belly of the pool.
Yes, sir. I've got
1854.
Chairman, members of the committee, I have a short line amendment. The purpose of the line amendment that is supported by the clerk is to address shift from the Department of Education to the Secretary of Education.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. On line four, after the Department of, after the strike, Department of Education, sir, Secretary of Education, comment, adjust to the School Readiness Committee, and that same amendment needs to be made on line 12, after the strike of the Department of Education, sir, Secretary of Education, comment, and projection.
Okay. Have a motion on the okie dokie. Okay. Discussion. Okay. All there, yeah. Okay. The bill is amended, of course.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. The fundamental issue that we have is, of course, is about the emotional learning. What we find from employers that one of the biggest problems is the soft skills. So employers are
1736.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, members. This is a request to extend the sunset provision from 2019 to 2023 for the Community Integration Advisory Commission sunset, Integration Advisory Commission. This is necessary to ensure that Virginia's continued progress towards compliance with the Supreme Court's Homestead decision. The extension is also keeping with the Commonwealth settlement of the Department of Justice over services by individuals with intellectual and mental disabilities. As you probably are already familiar with, the fact that the SEAC actually monitors the progress of state agencies towards community integration of individuals with disabilities in keeping with federal state law and the Supreme Court's Homestead decision. And the SEAC provides recommendations to the governor concerning community integration, and this sunset extension is a recommendation of the commission.
done with testimony. Is there any other discussion on the members? Any motion?
Mr. Chairman, I'm interested.
Okay, there's a motion, a second table bill. Please cast your vote. By a vote of 4-1, the measure laid on the table. We're going to do House Joint Resolution 588. Delegate Richard Bell, he is requested a patron. He's asked us to strike that measure. Okay. So there's a motion, a second. Please cast your vote. And by a vote of 5-0, the measure stricken from the dock. Next, I saw Delegate Aird. House Bill 2006.
Basically, House Bill 2006 attempts to establish a task force to create state
they're just as well off to get a letter and go ask the certain agency if they will do it. And if they will do it, then they can get it done that way. You don't necessarily need a piece of legislation. And you're going to see that happen a few times today, that we're going to say, you know, we don't entirely know their workload, so sometimes what we're going to do is say, contact them directly if we don't pass the legislation. Okay. Next is Elegant Yancey. Elegant Yancey, let's do your first one, 2168.
Mr. Chairman, the members have a simply put, a long-term plan whereby the Commonwealth of Virginia can lay out school construction, school modernization, retrofitting existing schools, what we can do for laboratory, we can have three-dimensional and augmented reality education. We can also address issues of importance, such as teacher pay rate salaries going forward. Likewise, we can also address issues about SLQs and SOLs, which I know is important for Senator Newman, who's kind enough to also speak with the Chairman of Appropriations about funding for this. The commission primarily is focused, and the duties are starting on line 64 through 75, and that lays out exactly what it is. So very simply put, Mr. Chairman, along the lines of consistency, predictability, stability, this lays out a long-term plan for the legislature to work throughout Commonwealth of Virginia to lay out the plan, what Virginia's going to need to do to have the appropriate education to find the, to have the kind of success that we need to have going forward for the future.
Do you have a budget amendment?
Mr. Chairman, I'll bring to your attention the lines 89 through 95, where we were able to ameliorate the situation through the clerk's office in both chambers. However, speaking to both Chairman Jones and Senator Newman, that they believe that they can carve out the appropriate funding in the budget when they speak together. I had that conversation today with the Chairman of Appropriations.
Okay. We may need to report and refer if that moves in that direction. So is anyone else here speaking in favor tonight?
Chairman, if I may, I'd like to bring your attention. New Board of News Public Schools has come out in favor of the bill and has recently received an email, but didn't want to report to your attention.
Okay. Is anyone here in opposition? Okay, committee?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
State of Mississippi, and what they're doing is they're just pouring the resources in on more do the schools have to have so that when the children are coming into the schools, they're also being able to graduate and being able to prepare immediately for the job hiring. So back to the chairman, I go one step forward since you brought it up, and I appreciate you bringing that up because it's something I neglected to note. That is, in working, part of this is to get the business community to be able, this is in relation to what Dr. Larry Filer at Old Dominion University has said at an economic development meeting, got to be able to have all sides of the table discussing going forward when a young person graduates from a public high school in Virginia with checking off all the boxes that is necessary for job hiring and placement, that if a child, if the state of Virginia is paying to get a qualification to check off the boxes, then we've got to be able to get the course immediately, and it's one of the problems that we're having. So the thought is, Mr. Chairman, in the design for these schools, in the retrofitting of these schools, and for these kind of laboratories for these schools, what is our plan, how are we going to do it, where are we, how are we going to get there, and how are we going to achieve it, and that's what the purpose of this commission seeks to achieve, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I appreciate what you're saying. And invite, it's not that I'm citing examples where that sort of thing has been done in Virginia. I cite it more new. You know, the first video was probably not a new idea. It's been around on a lot of different forms before. So my question would be whether or not we need to add another commission.
Thank you.
Okay.
Discussion committee. Much pleasure. A motion and a second to report. We're going to report it and we'll ask in the interim if maybe we have to go to appropriations. So,
that the General Assembly would say, since you are already speaking to the regulatory side of this capacity, why not go ahead and continue to have the conversations about all aspects of use of rainwater? And should there be the need for additional legislation to be submitted, we can address that in the 2020 session continue to engage in the conversations now, but also to seek out what other capacities can be done, put together the appropriate legislation, and then we can address it in the 2020 session. So it's just encouraging to continue to have a full conversation rather than wait for another bill and then an additional round of conversation, Mr. Chairman.
Any questions? Is anyone here to speak in favor of this measure? Anyone here to speak in opposition? Okay, so motion and a second to report and discussion. Please cast your vote. Measure reports 6-0.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, members.
Thank you, Doug.
Doug Poindexter here.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
We have House Bill 2265. Sir.
Chairman, members of the committee, this bill deals with the arterial preservation policy adopted by the Council of Transportation a couple of years ago. Basically, trying to move traffic on our primary roads like 220, 460, 229, 250, and using newer designs and not stop new traffic. This is the most of the designs. Bring the bills because in rural counties, the only place we have to put economic development projects is on the entire road. And our rural counties, we're not affording the $250 million that's required by construction. So the bill simply asks the transportation, the Department of Transportation Department to go back and review its policy and bring in the EDP, the
Thank you. Any questions from committee? Does anyone here wish to speak in favor of this measure? Anyone here speak in opposition? Okay, committee. Chair will entertain a motion. Measure dies for lack of a
motion. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. Is Delegate Hodges here? Delegate Rush? Let me see. We have the bill is HJ 677. Is that it?
That's correct, Mr.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, HJ 676 sets up a joint study.
677. Yeah, I misspoke.
Resolution 677 deals with blockchain technology, sets up a joint subcommittee to study the emergence and integration into the economy. 21-member joint subcommittee will coordinate the efforts for economic development, job creation, using this technology. This is emerging technology that, according to one recent survey, 10% of the world's GDP will be stored using blockchain technology. Actually have a very large player in this space. They have three offices, Hong Kong, London, and Blacksburg. And so this is a great economic development opportunity for the community. This will help us for that.
Thank you. Any questions for the committee? Anyone here speak in favor of the motion? Anyone here speak in opposition? Great. Okay, there's a motion and a second to report any discussion. Please cast your vote. Delegate Rush, looks like by a vote of 4-0, your measure moves forward. Okay. So, give me a verbal.
Nick Rush?
Looks like a vote of 6-0, your motion.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yeah. Okay.
Delegate Keene?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. You have two of them. We'll go with 2330.
Mr. Chair, I have a question. Resolution. I could wait a minute.
No, go ahead.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll just go in the order of your agenda.
Okay.
I'm going to sit because I have to. covers House Bill 2330, Mr. Chairman. I want to explain to you my interest and motivation for doing this bill, explain very briefly what the bill does, and try and answer any questions, obviously, but also want to give you an update on where things are as far as the administration on this issue. Mr. Chairman, about 20-odd years ago, when I was a young attorney, one of my first tasks that I've ever had to do in a job was to implement the National Government Policy Act, which was passed in 1970, but many federal agencies had not implemented the Policy Act in the fullest way. And so I discovered when I was working for the federal government that the agency I was working for had not ever implemented the National Environment Policy Act. So I ended up working on that for about 3 years, and as a result, I became inadvertently an environmental regulatory attorney. So having done that work in the past, I just assumed in Virginia we have an environmental policy, policy that we review on a regular basis. Turns out we really don't. And a couple of years ago, Governor McAuliffe had formed an environmental advisory council that looked at environmental justice specifically, as well as other parts of the environment, which I thought was a good move. What I thought was missing in our code right now is a requirement that all state agencies, regardless of where they are and what they're doing, if the state agency's funding or actions or decisions or regulations impact the environment vis-a-vis private sector as well as commercial entities or permitting, that we ought to include some analysis of environmental justice as part of that. So my bill has three components, Mr. Chairman. The first part is it would declare the policy of the Commonwealth that we require state agencies, whenever it takes action that impacts the environment, to look at the environmental impact on environmental justice. And to define what environmental justice is, the second part of the bill actually defines it in the latest language that's available at the federal level as well as throughout the states that have been looking at environmental justice. So we have a robust definition of what environmental justice is, what citizens ought to be using as a way for them to have an opportunity to access that. And finally, Mr. Chairman, I did create a codified advisory council, which I know just recently governors re-upped the advisory council that Governor McAuliffe had. So he is now in the process of reorganizing, or I guess refreshing the advisory council that he has. He doesn't have statutory authority for that. He's just doing it as an independent matter. So my bill would also include that piece as well. And I know there are other proposals for the advisory council, but I think the only thing that I would point out when I drafted this is that I wanted to make sure that the advisory council was made up mostly of experts out there who work on these issues, and in particular, those that might not have a conflict of interest with the company. So, for example, if you have a company that is hiring labor organizations to do a major proposal or infrastructure, you don't want that company sitting on the advisory council that oversees the environmental impact on that. So we excluded both labor and businesses so that they don't participate at the advisory council, so that the information is actually driven by public interest in the government sector. That's really all it does, and that you have to answer any questions.
Have any questions? Okay. Is there anyone here that opposes this measure? Any proponents of this measure? All right. We've got about 10 seconds.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, thank you. My name is Corina Bell. I'm with the Sierra Club Virginia chapter, and this is the bill.
Thank you.
10 seconds.
Yeah,
perfect. Hi, my name is Kendall Crawford. I'm with Virginia Interface Power and Light, a program of Virginia Interface Center for Public Policy, representing the connections to over 700 congregations across the state to support this bill.
Thank you.
And quickly, I'm Harrison Wells with the Chesapeake Climate Action Network and the CCAN Action Fund. We also support the bill.
I just answered the gentleman that he's right as far as the advisory council. Obviously, it's up to the governor how he wants to constitute it. I think my language is just a suggestion of how he could do it. And as you might remember from the appropriation side, because I've been in a budget amendment, it does have a fiscal impact because of the fact that we'll be paying for it by citizens board members and such. If the executives are hard for him, I'm happy to remove that portion, wait for the governor to do it. But I think the key is to have some language that requires our agencies to do policy. It may not be this year, but I'd love to work on this issue because ultimately, without that policy requirement, the advisory council really doesn't mean a whole lot.
Thank you. Okay. Great.
Chair Bales, to move forward. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Possible 2331. This is actually a really interesting issue. I learned about this a few months ago when I attended a National Conference of City Legislators meeting and talking to some attorneys and legislators about their work on environmental issues, especially on the western end of our country where you have a lot of wildlife. There's this concept that's brewing now, and I believe this is the first time we're talking about it in Virginia, called the wildlife corridors. It's really an interesting concept that, as we see a lot more development, and since we're in New York, and I speak about this a lot in our agriculture committee, of how our state is actually organized. You're all members of the agriculture committee. We have these conversations a lot where we talk about how our state is becoming more and more urbanized, and there are less and less agricultural rural areas. Part of the concern there is that with the wildlife that have been roaming around and such, all of a sudden they're now running into highways and transportation needs and such. And so to the extent that we can incorporate as part of our planning, our urban planning, this idea of wildlife corridors so that, you know, bears and deer and other of our four-legged friends and even fish and wildlife, that they can kind of have a place that they naturally would transit. The issue, unfortunately, is that obviously we can't do something like this in a vacuum, so I would have to create some kind of advisory council once again. And Mr. Chairman, I did put in a budget amendment. I have somebody that can speak on the overall conversation. I think that the governor's office and folks have told us that they're interested in working with us on this, but as of the budget, they aren't able to make that good. So, Mr. Chair, I'd give the rest of my time to.
Okay.
If somebody's here, let's see.
My name is Misty Bose, and I'm representing Wild Virginia and 26 other organizations around the state and thousands of our members. As you know, like Kim just mentioned, you know, this is a simple common sense first step in solving a very complex problem for the state of Virginia, and that's why we're looking at a multi-agency coordinated effort. So as you know, as our wildlife move, their safety and our safety keeps getting compromised, right? So if we need animals to move safely, we need to make sure that we are, consistently in the top 10. In the country for animal vehicle collisions, specifically deer. And that's very expensive, costs us millions every year, and this bill will help us move in the right direction to address that. So HB 2331 follows a very sensible national trend. We've seen states all around the country moving towards these sorts of studies, as well as groups formed together coordinating efforts to address habitat connectivity. So these efforts have attracted a lot of bipartisan support, and we want to put Virginia on the right track to do that here as well. If we're planning for patterns and planning for both wildlife and people, efforts like this to save money, as well as attracting the support of many organizations as we found, just bringing this up over the last year. We've attracted support from a lot of different organizations, and we've spoken to lots of different agencies, and while we haven't had any the formal sign, obviously, we have attracted some interest.
They'll get on lines 86 to 89, 72. How would that operate, making recommendations subject to the board of director regarding a road project? The council may recommend avoiding the corridor construction and crossing, or so on. How would that operate?
Sure, Mr. Chairman, and this is, as Mr. just said, it is a complex matter, and as you know, transportation projects don't come in one single model. There are so many different versions. You have so many different agencies and governmental agencies are involved in the funding as well as approval and local zoning. So it is absolutely a complex matter. I think the idea here is for, as we plan this out, it wouldn't be a specific, here's what we should divide anymore, here's what we should divide six more. As you're building highways, take these principles into consideration using the latest study. So the idea is the plan would be a plan that is drafted once, kind of generically with some good best practices, and then we would take that, plug it into a project and say, here are some principles that we'd like to meet. And so to the extent that the advisory council at the right time, I'm not sure where that would be in terms of during a public hearing or maybe before, that we would envision something where the experts would provide this information well in advance of being on another planner so that as if they hadn't forgotten to do this analysis, at least they'll have some resources available to them. And the idea is that's plan to be updated every few years as well.
It's interesting to me the county that I live in has an interesting center thing to the state park and prison. Fair amount of private property and then enormous track on James River. Fairly close to the channels. So I've heard
idea with us, and to the extent that we've had these conversations, both in committees and offline, it's happening anyway, and let's just make sure we're planning ahead, and as we have more and more urbanized areas, how we make sure that we're doing it all the right way. So my goal is to just make sure the right people are around the table thinking ahead so that we ultimately have the best plan possible. So whatever is up to you, I'm happy to go.
Yes.
I'd like to commend the delegate for bringing this to our attention also. I've been following some of this internationally, and what some other countries are doing in Europe, so it's really quite amazing. This is a kind of situation where we've got to do it sooner than later. Because once you close out the opportunity, and my area is a prime example, and I happen to live in Ruston, we have a lot of set aside space and corridors and so on. But for our county generally, I can say that's simply true. So however it is that we can make sure we don't stop the talking stuff about this, we do the idea forward. Thank you.
Chair, let me make a motion.
I really appreciate it, and I certainly will continue to work with you. Our last one, Mr. Chairman, is toward the end of your agenda, because the House Joint Resolution has passed their bill. House Joint Resolution 687. And this, let me tell you, sorry, it's a very brief background. I believe I've got at least a couple of folks from the industry that have been speaking with this. And Mr. Chairman, just also to grant the conversation you may be having later on, it's my good friend, Delegate Devin Atlantis. I agree with you absolutely that when we need to do things without having to code and just have the agency to do it, I'd like to do it that way. This one, the only question that I have is about separation of power. We're asking the Supreme Court, as opposed to just another government agency, to do a study that would be more within their jurisdiction. But what this study would request is that, as you know, Mr. Chairman, we have a fairly complicated way that we do taxes, tax policy, as well as tax appeals. If you are a commercial or a residential owner and your property assessment is one that you don't agree with, you can go to your local assessor and try to appeal that, or you can appeal it to the circuit court. What we found over the last dozen years or so is that each county and each circuit court has its own way of interpreting and their own way of dealing with issues. And so to the extent that they end up having inconsistencies, we've now seen legislation, in fact, Mr. Chairman, you know that Delegate Byron has a bill currently pending on the floor that deals with the exact problem of how do we make sure that the courts are interpreting in a consistent way the way we do appeals. So what I said would be best is if the Supreme Court would come back with some recommendation about what about creating a tax board, a specialized tax board that kind of takes all of this and provides uniformity and consistency so that we don't have these random decisions. I had two bills last year that came out of the United States of the House that was killed in the Senate because there was disagreement on what the assessment standard ought to be. So rather than us dealing with bill after bill, we can ask the Supreme Court to come back with some suggested ways that can streamline and also provide uniformity on this. Mr. Chairman, I have at least a couple of folks that would like to speak with this as to why it's important for their energy.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the Subcommittee. Brian Gordon on behalf of the Apartment and Office Building Association. As the delegate presented, this concept was born out of legislation from last year that passed the House of Delegates 100-0, and it developed concerns on the local government side of when it crossed over to the other body. We actually passed the bill by for the year and drew all the stakeholders together during the legislative interim, and this is the concept that we all coalesce around and be worthy of further exploration. So we are not aware of any application. We would ask for your support.
Anyone else wish to speak to the mayor?
Mr. Chairman, Brett Bassey, Virginia Manufacturers Association. Tax policy at the local level is getting more and more complicated. Right now, only 1% of all administrative appeals that are filed at the local level actually make it to being granted at the court level. And the principal reason is it's a $400,000 minimum to get to that point. Very few small businesses can make that. So what you find out is most businesses hit the Board of Equalization and they actually can't afford their own appeal to take it to get any sort of relief. And so the other thing that we found is we even have some larger members who have made that choice, but the problem is they get to the court and there may not be the sophistication to be able to do valuations, to do appraisals. So the court that is specifically focused on tax would have that competency. So we hope that you would start that process.
Anyone here opposed to this measure? Okay, committee. Discussion. Motion.
Report. Second.
Okay, there's a motion to report
vote of 4-3, measure reports.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd be happy to work with you after this to see if there's a better request to do this. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, being a career and tech teacher for 39 years, I guess as I look at this, I'm kind of going, what are we going to study that we don't already know? And the point being, we know that some folks learn better in a hands-on learning environment. I've never seen a study that doesn't show that all students don't potentially learn better in a hands-on type of environment than experiential learning. The challenge from everything I've seen over the years is one being the reason, most every school division, you're seeing 80% thereabouts or a little higher of all the students are in a college-bound track, which precludes them scheduling-wise of taking in advanced experiential learning classes. And secondly, school divisions face the financial challenges that experiential learning classes cost more. That when you put in shop facilities, they typically take up much more space than a classroom. Schools have done away with a lot of their career and tech programs for that very reason, and because of tight budgets, you take a shop and turn it into a half dozen classrooms, and you just added school space. We've got a very healthy, for outcome of it, I'm aware of, a cooperative education program where a student can go into the workforce in a career and tech field and get school credit in addition to being paid to do the job. So my question is kind of, what is this going to tell us we don't already know?
Thank you.
actually do this now. We have a Board of Education, the governor appoints members. We actually added a business member to the board at the request of the chamber to ensure we were including that stakeholder group. We have policies in place, and as Delegate before I said, I get a little frustrated sometimes when I'm going to say to the business community, because you all keep asking us to do these things, and they're already responsible for doing it. So talk to the Board of Education members, talk to the superintendent. For goodness sakes, talk to the Secretary of Education. But that's their responsibility. And by, you know, by us asking them to do it, yes, you know, we're passing a piece of legislation that we say this is important, but if it's important for education policy in the Commonwealth of Virginia, it should be important for the board and the Department of Education to address. And from my perspective, it's their job to do this. We don't need to tell them it's their job. And I think sometimes we think that we have to direct them. And I said this on the floor, so I'm on another piece of legislation, not even related, that we ask agencies time and time again to do their job. Well, just go ask them to do their job. We don't need legislation to do that. They're authorized to do it now. And I wonder why we keep having pieces of legislation, Section 1 bills, resolutions, all those kinds of things that already ask them to do what is their responsibility and that they can do now.
Okay, Chair, I'll entertain the motion. Okay, Delegate Paul.
I don't want to break out the discussion, but I'm sure the frustration is going to be expressed by Delegate Jones. But I would say to you, I think that happens in the practical matter of the Department of Education. It has so much to do. But what it needs then is to help with prioritization. And it seems to me we want to get into safety. This is a priority. And I will for you admit that they made it a priority that they're doing right now. But it doesn't seem to me that it happens. And I can cite examples that I know of my own experience of how that happened. So once again, since this is a priority that so many people agree to, let's call them again.
Motion and a second to lay the bill on the table. Please cast your vote. And by a vote of 4. By a vote of 4-3, the measure fails.
Yes, sir.
Currently, the Ethics Council is mandated to hold at least 4 meetings a year. Most other legislative commissions and agencies meet at the call of the chair, and the majority of members are so requested. Commission on Media cannot agree with them all, which they are. So this legislative change will make the Ethics Council requirement identical to those other agencies. This is a formal request of the Ethics Council, and the staff unanimous to buy that. And I do have the executive director here to ask you to please help answer any detail.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Stuart Petta, Ethics Council. As Billy said, this was a formal recommendation that was passed by the council off the deliberation.
Move your report.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion and a second to report. Any discussion? Please cast your vote. Okay, Delegate Chambers.
Oh, yes.
I vote 7-0 to measure moves forward. I counted it.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The next measure is a study 620. Recycling rate. We study the reduction of municipal solid waste generated within a solid planning unit. This comes from the city enforcement, and I do have a phone friend behind me who is with the city public utilities.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Erin Schrinner with the public utilities for the city of Portland. As cost continues to escalate, many localities are being tasked with evaluating the financial viability of their recycling program. In addition to recyclables being diverted to landfills as a result of economic decisions, the demand for lower contamination rates in recycled materials has led to an increase in the amount of material diverted to landfills by processing facilities. Industry leaders estimate that 1/4 to 1/3 of all recyclables materials are considered contaminated and therefore disposed of in landfills. The impact of the high demand and the changing recycling market has resulted in many outcomes which conflict with the core values of recycling. Therefore, it's necessary to study the impact of the China ban is having on the locality, holistically evaluate the effects of reducing the recycling rate to develop solutions to these pressing issues. As a locality member of the Southeastern Public Service Authority, Portsmouth, along with the cities of Chesapeake, Virginia Beach, and Norfolk, support this effort.
Thank you. Mayor, of course, with John Rowe, do you concur with that?
Yes, sir.
I kind of thought you would.
It's getting harder and harder to find buyers for recycling in the international market. So this is important.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay, this measure. Okay, discussion. Oh, yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Chair, members of the committee, Sherry Young, the government affairs manager for city enforcement. I just want to say quickly, work with Senator Maxwell, the chief of staff. I've been up there for almost 30 years. 30 years we have a building for recycling, for
You okay with that?
Yes, all right.
By a vote of 7-0, the motion carries.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
Can I ask my colleagues on to my right if they would kindly probably use their mics so we can hear you? We're not hearing you.
Okay.
And we want the benefit of your conversation.
Expertise?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I'm a delegate wear and I have to share one.
Oh, okay.
Delegate Herring. Yes, ma'am.
Is this one you've heard before?
Well, no, so mine's different.
Okay.
And I was out of the room, but I heard y'all, I heard about your concern.
Okay.
So I think it's very useful. I go to three prime lines. This is something that existed for previous administration. It wasn't previous administration.
Yeah.
The bills for this were filed before the government issued the executive order. So I know that's a concern that there's something already out there. Mine is different than Delegate Keene's, and since it is very streamlined at the development of those companies, there is a seat on there for industry to be on there. And as well as labor, well as environment, a seat for secretary, and we don't have a lot of ex officio members. And the intent of this also is to just make sure that we're having a full and complete conversation and not one-sided view when we're talking about environmental justice. So, I mean, that's basically what this bill is dealing with. Here we go.
Okay. Any questions for the committee this time? Okay. Anyone here to speak in favor of the measure? Okay.
Harrison Wallace, CCAN Action Fund. We're in support of the bill and anything that can keep the council going so that we can build a real process on environmental justice and making sure that we're tackling that issue.
Kimball Crawford, Virginia Interface Power and Light, program of Virginia Interface Center for Public Policy with connections to 700 congregations across the state. We believe that environmental justice is a more important issue that people do care about. Support this bill.
Anyone here in opposition? Discussion, motions.
Report.
Okay, there's a motion and a second to report. Any discussion? Okay, please cast your vote, please. By a vote of 3-4, the measure does not move forward. Thank you. So, we have two, H.J. 580 and 581.
Yeah. Could start off, if it gets you in a good mood, I'd ask that you table 580.
So moved.
Second. Okay. Basically, these were two.
Yes. Okay, please cast your vote.
I have a vote of...
By a vote of 7-0, I've got you, Delegate Ward.
Okay.
By a vote of 7-0, that measure laid on the table.
All right, 581 was kind of inspired by our efforts last year with I-81. It's a little bit different approach. What it would do is it would ask the Commonwealth Transportation Board to come up with a strategic plan through I-95 between exit 118, which is Thornburg,
projects across different jurisdictions. Because most smart scale projects percolate up from a local project and then a regional and on like that. This is a big project that really you got to come up with a plan to deal with. It stretches beyond several different localities, and really I think it's long overdue. The way we ended up with the hot lanes, and the hot lanes, I will say they have helped with the move traffic, however they've been very controversial. Because we took the HOV lanes and turned them into toll lanes. We expanded them and turned them into toll lanes. And the way we ended up with the hot lanes, because for years, at least on 95, the HOV lanes ran down to Prince William County and ended there for decades. And you'd go ask VDOT, well, when do you have a plan? When are you planning to extend them further south into Stafford? And they'd say, well, we have no plan. And that gave Transurban the opportunity to say, hey, we'll put you in front. And right now, we're kind of in a similar situation with I-95, that corridor. It's already congested. More growth is coming to the area. Amazon coming to Northern Virginia is going to have a big impact on I-95. And you ask UDOT, well, when are you going to add another lane to 95? They said, we have no plans. So I'm trying to get them, the CPB, to step up and do their job and come up with a plan, strategic plan for that section
995. That's true. Yes, sir. I'd
love to ask for support. Okay. Is anyone here to wish to speak in support of this measure? Is there anyone in opposition?
Mr. Chairman, I guess I just asked Delegate Colmer's name for Bob Lament. Actually, I'm supportive of the project. Projects that you said in your statement one was, yes, I believe that was last year. I guess, are you prepared for some of the options that they may come up with? Because some of the options sometimes are things that you think you would never vote for, and then they come forward and say, you know, this is the solution.
Yeah. Well, right now, I'm also at the point where I think any solution is better than no solution, which is what we have right now. The corridor is the corridor, for when we had the Great Recession hit, you know, the Fredericksburg area was booming. Stafford, Spotsylvania County were booming with a lot of growth and everything until the Great Recession hit. And that kind of put a brake on everything. People catch their breath a little bit anyway. So now we're starting to see the growth pick up again in the Fredericksburg area. And 75% of all these new people coming to the Fredericksburg area are going to want to get on I-95 and go to work and come home at night. And like I said, VDOT saying no plans to add a lane to I-95 is just not acceptable.
Mr. Chairman, Delegate Cole, has the delegation actually gone to the CPC and asked them to address this?
I've talked to the Commissioner of VDOT and the Secretary of Transportation. They did not object to it. They deferred the CPB, the Secretary deferred the CPB passing rather than sending it to the Joint Study.
Any other questions? Committee? Motions?
Mr. Chairman, I'll make it up. Trouble on here.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion and a second to report. Any discussion?
Yeah.
Please cast your vote. Everyone voting? Vote is 5-2 to measure this law.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Delegate, let's see, I think, Delegate, 2466.
5-year period from 2013 to 2018, we had 636 accidents on this 2.1 mile stretch of road, resulting in 177 visible injuries, 126 non-visible injuries, 15 severe injuries, and 1 fatality. At the same time, the level of service that we actually see on this road here is graded F. At every peak time during the AM and the number of times during the PM rush hour as well. And even when we looked at a 40-year-old, no built site, we don't do anything else, especially when there's tests it looks like. Everything in red here, these are all F. So basically, the area fails in that regard. On what's out, we have to take part.
Traffic on 28 was essentially a standstill. We'd often have to respond by traveling down the center lane, extremely dangerous with collision with other vehicles. If we are involved in a vehicle collision, we are out of service and cannot continue to respond to the emergency we are heading to. In our line of work, whether a structure fire or a heart attack call, traffic on Route 28 lies in danger, not just on that stretch of road, but the community it surrounds.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman. First moved to Manassas from California in 2000 to work in D.C. Traffic on 28 was bad then. Before they widened I-66 to go all the way out to Haymarket, Route 28 was my route from the evening to come up. And generally, I remember it took back then in 2004 approximately 30 minutes for me to make from the I-66 to Route 28 officially to my apartment that was on Ashland Avenue. Now, fast forward to 2019, it now takes me just over an hour to make Route 28, the interchange of 66 Route 28, to the Braddock Road intersection. Just to make it from Route 28, to Braddock Road and to Lauderdale Avenue. When my nephew was rushed to Rescue Hospital in March of 2018 with a traumatic brain injury, I was unable to reach the hospital before he went into surgery. Thankfully, he survived. So the lights at Compton Road.
We're out of time, so wrap it up, please.
The lights at Braddock Road, Maxwell Road, and Compton Road routinely back traffic up into Manassas. So this study is a great thing.
I think I may cut this short. Valley Grown, I think maybe you may have just gotten a message that VDOT may be able to do this administratively. So I think with that, we may be able to lay this bill on the table.
That's what I was going to ask. All of us have issues like this in our community. Obviously, this is serious. But is the department's responsibility and the locality's responsibility to make these a priority? The other thing I think, Delegate Brown, is it's kind of precedent setting. If we were to do this, we talked about the Christmas tree on the floor of the house today. Alcohol licenses localities. We would have every locality, all 130 some of them, come forward and ask and justify the contract that they got to do something legislatively for every project. And that's just problematic in the process. So I appreciate your advocacy for it, and I know it's a serious issue because obviously the product team is going to have
to. I think you've got some light at the end of the tunnel.
Chairman, members of the committee, I know Route 28 is the segment you're talking about. Some people talk about 95 and the worst traffic in Virginia. Here's a competitor for the worst traffic around. And in some regards, I appreciate the fact that the Department of Transportation is willing to do this, but I would hope that we could figure out some way to send. send a message to them to do it. In other words, let's not just have a conversation and have it done. Let's send a letter to the committee to say that you look at this and move forward on not studying, but making plans.
Okay, committee? Measure as we like. Thank you. We already killed two or three of them. Dang. Okay. Sure.
Okay, so thank you very kindly, Mr. Chairman, and to members of the committee here. HJ 671, this is the substitute that's phrased, I guess you should probably, you should have that properly.
Substitute. I move the adoption of the substitute.
All right, thank you. Okay, all fair side. Any substitutes, of course.
So the substitute for HJ 671, request the Department of Ground Quality Transportation State develop best practices to maximize cost efficiency of commuter rail and light rail projects. Commuter rail and light rail transit increase jobs, boost economic development, property value, and reduce pollution and traffic congestion, all while supporting health growth. Commuter and light rail transit continue to be an integral part of regional transportation systems with important commitment to ensure these systems are operating with integrity and the latest available technology for maximum efficiency. There have been many technological advances in innovative engineering costs and development recent years to maximize cost allocation for commuter and light rail projects. For example, this can include studying innovations regarding public systems that streamline improved routing, transit services, information technology tools, communication-based train control, and updating data transmission technologies to aid in real-time train location. By studying best practices in tier systems in other states and countries, this study will ensure our Commonwealth has access to the best information available so we can spend our commuter and light rail dollars with the smartest, most efficient action.
Okay. Any questions? Anyone here to speak in favor of the motion?
Yes, my name is Colin Robinson. I'm a resident of Gainesville for the last 13 years at Heritage Heights. People here that have interest in this type of research. We've had a lot of improvements done on 66, which brought a little more traffic our way. And we're getting ready for a 2,000-car parking lot. Probably won't reduce that. So unless we're planning on the second level on the highway of 66, we find a lot of support in our community for doing some serious research on this technology and finding alternatives to cars up here.
Good afternoon. My name is Kenny Cody, and I'm a resident of Woodbridge, Virginia. And I commute the trifecta Dunwoody Trinity in Prince William County through 95, 66, 28. And I can tell you that I get stuck at that Gainesville interchange all the time. I'm stuck in traffic, whether it's going to work, whether it's going to the airport. And the more options we have for everyone, the better off we'll be.
Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Cassie Crowell. I'm a longtime commuter on 66. 66 is one of the worst roads ever. And there's many times throughout the day that it's completely stopped going in either direction. We desperately need light rail options. I myself have taken VRE. It's a much safer, saner way to travel for commuters. So I really want to underscore the need to study the most economical way we can achieve that option.
Thank you. Is anyone here in opposition to this?
Not opposition, okay. But clarification. Chris Smith, the Department of Railroad Transportation.
Okay.
I would appreciate the delegate, any members of the bill. I would just point out that DRPT is the nature of our grant process, and also with our colleagues at DOT as part of the smart scale process, do take into effect cost plans and cost allocations for commuter and light rail projects, especially large projects at the scale that may use federal money. It is a federal requirement from the administration to do it.
I was just asking, gentlemen. First of all, thank you for both the NEDS last night.
Okay.
I was at the
function,
and I heard the Secretary of Transportation speak to this broad topic, that this is what y'all are about. And I'm trying to understand why we would need a resolution for y'all to tell you to do what I think you're already doing.
Thank you, Doug, Mr. Chairman. I, you know, it is the will of the grass and the Commonwealth Transportation will be bringing grass in addition to that.
Yeah, should we respond to the, I'll just tell the delegate that the pledge amendment that comes along with this is part of the reason why we have some legislation with the resolution.
Okay, ready? Move report. Okay, motion dies for lack of a second.
Sorry, second.
Okay. Okay, there's a motion that's been seconded to remove the substitute. Please cast your vote.
That's one.
I don't guess anything.
Yeah.
Is that not?
Do it also.
Oh, okay, here it is.
I have voted 3-3 to measure fails. Delegate Packing. House Bill 2767.
Bill 2767 establishes the Virginia African American Advisory Board to advise the government regarding the development of economic, professional, cultural, educational, and governmental links between the Commonwealth and the African American communities. The board will be a simple, will resemble that of the Virginia Asian Advisory Board and the Virginia Latino Advisory Board established in 2001-2003.
Anyone here?
Oh, I'm sorry. It's okay. It's, we do have to check for it.
Okay.
I call and check for it.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, amendments offered. First, line 19 introduced after membership of strike 27, insert 26. Amendment 2, line 20 introduced after and strike 6, insert 5. Amendment 3, line 23 introduced after resources, insert and. Amendment 4, line 23 introduced after safety, strike the comma. Amendment 5, line 23, introduced after safety, comma, and strike transportation and serve homeland security. Amendment 6, line 66, introduced at the beginning of the line, strike 7, insert 5. Amendment 7, line 66, introduced after 1 year term, strike 6, insert 5. Amendment 8, line 66, introduced after 2 year term, strike 5, insert 6. Amendment 9, line 67, introduced after and, strike 3, insert 5.
Thank you, Anna. Okay, all of that, Jack?
All right.
Okay, your minutes, of course. Okay, yeah, we didn't have any speakers, so questions? I've got a question.
I'll be back at the other two groups of officers in the executive branch currently.
Yes.
And Mr. Chairman, were they created by statute?
You might understand they were created by statute. The bill is, I believe, reflective of the bills that were used for those two instances.
I'm
have another one. Do I see that one up?
Yes, sir.
That one might be a little swifty. Might approve that back. So, HJ 664 is a resolution. This resolution is a recommendation from the School Leadership and Student Outcome Work Group with the Joint Committee to study the future of public education and secondary education in the Commonwealth to address the shortage in Virginia, the teacher shortage in Virginia. The subcommittee recommended that the Department of Education study the teacher licensure process and assessment requirements for an in-hand advice that may prevent minority teachers candidates from entering the profession.
Yeah, question of faith. You tell me that I have to serve on the advisory board of teacher education and licensure. And they had their meeting just this Monday, and actually this topic was one of the items on their agenda. Are you aware that AFTEL is already looking at the issue of minority individuals in the profession, initial hiring and retention?
I was not.
It's already happened in AFTEL.
Yes, Mr. Speaker, I think we're I think in past years, the last couple of years or so, we've dealt with this issue. It's been addressed. Look at that.
Mr. Chairman, to that end, I think that's part of why AFTEL is already looking at the matter.
Yeah. I have more. I'm going to let it go. It's so late in the day. I'm just going to let that one happen pass, and I'm going to walk away.
Chair, I'll entertain a motion.
Let me start. Let me do this. I just want to have a little bit of fun with you. Can I just make a motion and just lay it on the table?
Yeah, go ahead. Go
Motion
second.
I need to
build
a table.
Yes.
this resolution just assures that not only does it happen this year, and again, we appreciate the letter, but there is a date, but that they inform you that they actually did do the work that we've been asking them to do every year.
Mr. Chairman, I'm captain. The resolution says requests that the board at all times. So we're not telling them, we're not directing them, we're asking them, right?
Mr. Chairman and Delegate Landis, and I apologize, yes. But the, yes, but the important thing was that, that they would have to inform you on what action, if any, they took.
Just as a comment, you know, this is also something that AFTEL has on their agenda. The AFTEL is comprised of individuals, it's legislative members, but it represents the entire teacher profession, administrators, as well as DOE staff. We meet quarterly or more frequently. Their purpose is teacher educator licensure and certification issues, evaluation.
I'm actually a member of AFTEL. I'm the parent appointee as a member of Virginia PTA. And this is not what AFTEL should discuss this work and make recommendations. I've been on AFTEL for 6 years. We have never taken up this work or made recommendations to the board.
Mr. Chairman, I would be happy to ask the chairman of the House Education Committee to write to the board chairman and board members and ask them to move this up on their priority list. Support of the Virginia Education Association, Mr. Delegate Rodman, if that would help.
Very generous of you.
And I think that would be in line with what we kind of handle with others of the country.
Okay. Can we take a motion?
Move the label with the letter.
Okay. We have a motion to lay the bill on the table with a letter.
Okay.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Please cast your vote. Is everybody voting?
Yes.
Okay. I vote a 6-0 to bill play the table. Okay. Delegate Lindsey.
Chairman, members of the committee, I'm not even going to sit down because this is going to be very brief. Here on HCA 1662, 616, I can tell you that we were here last year. You know, the concern is great, and you know, and we do believe it's an issue that needs to, you know, have greater focus. This board or this committee was kind enough last year to encourage the stakeholders to have meetings and have a greater dialogue on the subject matter. I'm not absolutely pleased with the progress that has been made, but more recently, better progress has been made, and I'm taking the stakeholders at their respective words that this is something that we need to dialogue on. So for that reason, you know, I reasonably expect that a motion is in order to gently, I'll either strike it or I'll let you gently lay it on the table.
I'll make a motion to gently lay it on the table.
Can I be somebody other than him?
This vote doesn't count, his machine doesn't work. It is okay. Please cast your vote.
Thank you.
I think I made that half.
Thank you.
I voted 6-0 to make it play on the table.
Water quality on urban streams. We have litter problem. I'm not going to go. We all know that. I'm not
request this value that economic impact clear on finishing farming and water quality. And with that, after this study's done, you'll be able to analyze, considerably accept the commercially viable methods of drainage interventions, abatement management, removal from any source, and propose some strategies, campaigns, and necessary state actions to protect the economy from harm caused by litter or promotion agreements at non welfare. And that's simply all it does. I do have a budget amendment because it's going to. DEQ is going to have to contract with an economist to do the study, and if you want to send it to your appropriations, I can help you with the proper thing to do.
Anyone here voice their support?
Yes, sir. Steve Carter, Lovejoy with the Virginia Sierra Club. We support this. I will point out that I've been sitting at a lot of different subcommittees watching bills to give localities an opportunity to do something about litter. They've all been going down, but I've heard a lot of delegates at the same time say that they think that it's a problem that needs to be addressed. This can help to move that forward. So I appreciate your support for this.
Thank you.
Chairman, I'm Pat Calvin on behalf of Virginia Conservation Network. That's the same way Doug Carr and others have brought forth some legislation to manage plastics in our waterways and the impacts. We think this is a great way of dealing with it. It will not serve as an undue burden amongst any industry, we hope. to that end, I hope you don't hear any opposition.
Move to recording report.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion and a second to report and refer.
Discussion?
Please cast your vote. By a vote of 3-3, the measure does report.
Thank you, Chair.
Vote, Harry.
Oops.
I just turned the numbers. Usually 628. Asks the community council to really take a look at threat of fishing impacts, which have been occurring, we believe, as a result of the disclosure of public employees and private citizens' information response requests. Have the mayor of the city of Portsmouth and the city attorney here to answer questions. I think it's clear to all of us that, you know, while we balance the need for transparency and producing public information under the Freedom of Information Act, at times, especially given the immense creativity of a lot of folks now who want to be efficient in anticipation of potential groundwide illegal conduct, it's increasingly necessary to take additional steps to protect public private information, which could allow individuals to use that information to register. A case in point, the city of Portsmouth, I believe other localities, I recently experienced a situation where an individual was able to basically spoof himself as the fire chief for the locality and sent a series of emails around city government asking for various information, which was responded to by city employees who could not tell the difference. I had a similar situation in the city enforcement recently with a member of the human resource department where an individual was able to spoof those communications as well. I think this is getting fairly serious. We have both Mayor Rowe and City Attorney Solomon asking here to answer questions that the committee may have in this regard.
Thank you. Anyone here speak in favor?
Mr. Chairman, Solomon Ashby, City Attorney, as the Delegate Harrington has mentioned, over the last year, our office is involved in 2 or 3 different ventures. And with those fishing and probing activities, it is increasing the cost, and therefore we ask for their support so that we can take a look at these issues. Understanding we have the obligation to provide the information, but the data we're required to provide for public entities and the information we're required to provide for private individuals who engage the municipality in one single transaction can end up harming individuals if that information is passed along in response to FOIA requests.
Mayor,
may I ask for your favorable consideration?
Thank you. Anyone else to speak to this motion? Okay, Delegate Mann.
I just got a question for Delegate Harrington. I'm trying to figure out, knowing I've never served on the Virginia State Information Council, I think
to lay the bill on the table, what with the letter.
Okay.
Please cast your vote. A vote of 6-0.
Thank you, sir.
Kelly Tyler, you're very last on the list. But we can hear you now. I know how you like to grab party tonight. Me and Kelly Tyler, we've been partying together tonight. I know you need a head start on me. That's right, I apologize. We have House Resolution 217.
Yes, sir. Basically, this is a bill directed to the 9-member joint committee of HWI, Militia, Police, and Public Safety, and non-legislative members to establish a study to be done on the staffing level, the rate of staff turnover, employment conditions, employees' health and safety, and employee compensation at the Virginia Department of Corrections. Last year, there was about 1,587 officers who left the Department of Corrections. Therefore, the turnover rate remains still very high. This study would not only just study the turnover rate at the Department of Corrections, but it also would include, did the officers just leave for salary, basically, or did they leave because of the high risk of contagious diseases, or did they leave just because of the poor work habits or the work environment and poor implementations of policies and procedures? This study would have to generate accurate findings and evidence that will create or make recommendations for changes to the Department of Corrections. I think we have someone here to speak to the bill as well, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Anyone here wish to say?
Yes.
Mr.
Chairman, members of the committee, my name is John Bale, I'm the staff for the District Public Safety Office. And we would like to get the committee to support this resolution because since 2012, the department has been losing more than 1,000 correctional officers every year, with 2017 2018 being the highest 2 years. In 2017, the department lost 1,444, and in 2018, as you heard, Governor Tyler, it's 1,587. When we look at the cost of training, in 2017, the estimated cost was $17,427 to train one person to replace something that had left. The application process was about $216 for one person. When we look at the cost that it would be to train and replace those that left in 2018, it would have been somewhat over $30 million to train those officers. We feel that this study is very badly needed. There are some driving factors that are contributing to the turnover, one being salary. At this committee, Director Clark presented some information last year, let it be known that salaries was a problem for retention. But that's not the only factor. There are several others.
Thank you, sir. We're out of time, but y'all, I see y'all back there. You want to add your concurrence?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Delegate Tyler, as chair of HWI, do you think that if I would write a letter to corrections and ask them to speak to the issues you raised there in 43-44, that will help to get things in a posture where we at least get some information out of it and not create a little joint? Actually, I think we might be able to do it quicker than the previous study.
Okay. Well, I think the main thing
against
the rock is that letters have been done before. We talked to people in the administration and met with Secretary of Public Safety.
chairman of the Public Safety Subcommittee and Appropriations. That's right, you're on there too. So why don't you and I work together through that, because that's going to be the fastest way. In addition to if Chairman Allrock would write a letter, we'll work that together.
Thank you.
Chair will entertain a motion. There's a motion to lay the bill on the table.
Clarifications, can I lay it, the motion is to lay it on the table, but what action is going to be taken?
With a letter from the chairman of HWI, and then with Delegate Tyler and myself on the Public Safety Committee of Appropriations.
Okay.
Trying to write.
Thank you.
Please cast your vote. I vote 7-0. Measures laid on the table. Get a head start on me tonight.
I'd like to find out, I have several constituents in the district that I represent. We should bring a very important concern. I know you all are taking that seriously, but I have a second.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
I believe we're going to start with HJ 626.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. HJ 626 is shingles awareness. As most of you all are aware, that shingles is caused by the same virus as chickenpox. This is not terribly preventable, but it certainly helps with the shingles vaccine. What this does is simply has the Department of Health increase awareness of shingles and the shingles vaccine. Folks that are 50 and older should now be receiving that vaccine. However, only about 30% of Virginians have been under a vaccine. So this journey is simply has us raise the awareness of shingles, and then has the Department of Health report back on its progress in providing more awareness to the general. I'm happy to go into more detail.
Let's see if any questions at this point. Is anyone here to speak to this measure? Yes, ma'am. Okay.
My question is, and I'm familiar with it, and I have taken it, but why is it that insurance companies don't want to pay for it after a certain age?
So I'm not sure what the insurance company's logic is. I know that the CDC had made recommendations, the of 65 and over. That recommendation has now been changed to 50 and over. Mainly was offered to folks that were 60 years old. I know when I went to my last visit, my doctor said, you should get a shingles, and my insurance company was going to report that there wasn't 65 yet. Now that the recommendation is 50, I'm hoping that more insurance companies will take it.
Okay, 626. What's your pleasure?
Move the report.
Okay, there's a motion and a second. Report, please cast your vote. I vote 7-0.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There is a substitute in HJ 626. Chairman, HJ 662, the Joint Commission on Healthcare, to evaluate using pharmacists to work in access to care. Other states have looked at using pharmacists under certain private practice agreements and protocols where the pharmacists themselves directly provide services. We currently do this with vaccines now, and other states do contraceptives. Other commonly used medications that can be done by the pharmacist in collaboration with a physician. There's a lot to consider as we move forward with this, and so I believe that the plan is for a 2-year study of drug addiction healthcare with a report in the report at the first year, looking at the different aspects of protocols, private practice agreements, and working with all the stakeholders to make sure that we implement this correctly and safely.
Okay, any questions? Anyone here to speak to this measure? Yes, thank you.
Hi, good evening. Thank you, Delegate Sally. I'm Christina Borelli, the Executive Director of the Virginia Pharmacists Association. 93% of Americans will live within 5 minutes of a pharmacy, so we very much look forward to this study and what it has to do. So thank you.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Sarah Rose Wells with Medical Society of Virginia and AB Support Health.
Anybody else? Committee?
Sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Michelle Chester, Executive Director of the National Healthcare Community. We'd be happy to do this.
Thank you.
Good report.
That is good. There's a motion and a second to report the substitute. Please cast your vote. A vote of 7-0, your measure was followed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. That was the committee. Thanks very much.
Follows number one, line four, in the title after the Department Strike of Social Concern for Aging and Rehabilitative. Two, line 27, after the Department Strike of Social Concern for Aging and Rehabilitative. Three, line 30, after the Department Strike remainder of line 30, Concern for Aging and Rehabilitative. Number four, line 33, after study, comma, the Department Strike of Social Concern for Aging and Rehabilitative. Five, line 39, after Department Strike remainder of line 39 and through Rehabilitative on line 40, Concern for Social. Number six, line 42, after Department Strike of Social Concern for Aging and Rehabilitative. And number seven, line 44, after Department Strike of Social Concern for Aging and Rehabilitative.
Move the amendment. Without objection, the amendment is approved.
Mr. Chairman, we need to support our elderly, get without them. More and more members of the Commonwealth are electing to have in-home care for their mother or father as they get older. And more and more people are taking advantage of folks who are coming up with throughout the Commonwealth. And I hear stories where a son goes with his father and says his dad reads the book. It turns out they hire somebody to do in-home care to keep the folks with.
hard. I understand and applaud your effort. I guess my question, if this is going to happen, shouldn't we do it across the board in so much as with child daycare providers? Similarly, require child background, background check. Folks that work in recovery institutions. So I guess if it's going to happen, shouldn't it be to the broader language you had originally for social services? Because I think that's who handles background checks anyway, not dogs. Well, I guess, Mr. Chairman, that my thought being, while I understand his intent, if you're going to do it, you need to load it up. Because if you're going to do it, you need to do it for everybody. And candidly, I think loading it up would sink the vote for this to go forward. Would it be agreeable to you if we work together and I send a letter to DSS and see what are the legal obstacles to, and the financial obstacles, creating this type of system?
My bad. In keeping with what what the chairman suggested, I move we lay the bill on the table with the request that the chairman of HWI, gentleman to my right, send a letter to the Joint Commission.
And they've agreed to do to accept it and to do it. Okay. Yes, there was a second. Okay, so the motion is to lay the bill on the table. Please cast your vote. By a vote of, is everyone voting? It wants to vote. Okay.
Is Matt?
By a vote of 7-0, the bill's laid on the table. House Bill 2759. Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, before you begin presenting, Delegate Sickles, did you request unanimous consent for introduction of this measure? I'm looking at the bill was offered January 17th. The bill creates a study about procedural resolution. Study bills had to be introduced by the first day of session.
I did not. But I did thought it was a different, it was probably a different bill that I'm before we turn into the second one bill.
Mr. Chairman, I'm looking at the introduced language, and clearly it's a study. And
yeah.
That I'm just procedurally, if it was a study put in after January 9th, then it's not properly introduced, and so therefore not properly before us.
Mr. Chairman, that's a surprise to me. I could ask for unanimous consent tomorrow, and we could take testimony on tonight. I don't know when the next time you're meeting is, but that is a complete surprise to me. I have witnesses here that want to speak about this. A little bit of an urgent problem that we've got unrolling here, and wanted to get a handle on it before it takes off like some of these other.
Delegate Sickles, do you know what the posture of the same bill is in the Senate? Is there a parallel track?
I do not know.
Mr. Chairman, yes, there is. Mark Lewis, Robin Sanders, Representative.
Do you know what posture that is in over there?
It's going to be heard tomorrow in the full Senate transportation.
Okay.
I mean, Mr. Chairman, unfortunately, the challenge I think we've got with this measure is it was introduced after the deadline, and therefore in violation of the procedural resolution to be adopted from the body.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, if this bill was introduced as legislation, and during, before the deadline, we were discussing transferring it to turn it into a study, which Legislative Services did. That's what is before you today.
Well,
So when you introduced it, if you introduced it as a resolution at that time, you were ahead of the deadline.
No, it would have been.
When you introduced the bill, it had been a resolution, it would have been on time?
I believe so.
I'm not sure about that. The legislation was on time.
Yes.
Okay. Let me get clarification, because those of us are not parliamentarians, getting confused. The original bill was introduced and asked for unanimous consent.
No.
I didn't need unanimous consent because I introduced the bill on time.
Okay. So you introduced the bill on time, and it was a
regular piece of legislation.
Did it call for a study?
It did. I don't think it did. Did it call for a study?
I guess my challenge, I hear what you're saying, but here's this, it introduced, and this is a Section 1 bill. So there is no amendment needed to substitute to a bill that was introduced previously and then turned into a study, because if it did that, that becomes a second parliamentary problem under the rules of the House. We can't turn a bill into a study. So I guess either way you want to slice the bread, I don't see how by the rules of the House he'd be properly before us this evening.
Mr. Chairman, nobody warned me about this who was working on this in the Legislative Services, so this is a big surprise to me.
really wouldn't be properly before us at this time. So, you know, of course, what your options are. You could ask for unanimous consent. We're going to meet with the full committee again. And also, we could see the posture of the bill coming over and see what that does. So,
accordingly for the future. So we're very keenly aware of this problem. If you have any questions on recurrent flooding, but this is a huge challenge for all of us. Recurrent flooding, it's affecting our economy, our schools, our property values, and we need to have BDOT on board to be able to plan for our future. This action, if I may, Mr. Chairman, I think there are two bottom amendments that we can have, and BDOT actually had recommended that we have this.
We don't have it, sir.
Actually, it's two changes, and I can do those two in proper. And actually, we're making two simple changes, which were at the recommendation of VDOT. On line 17, at the beginning, change that to 2020. And then on the following line, after D, 2020, strike 2020 and change that to 2021. And when I spoke to VDOT, they actually said they can. Those are all the amendments, yes, sir.
Okay, you have amendments, of course. I have a motion on the amendments.
So moved.
Okay. All the papers, yeah.
Okay.
The bill is amended, of course.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. As amended, it extended those timelines. VDOT actually, in speaking with them, they had no opposition to the bill. They said they would actually work with the Center for Recurrent Flooding. and developed that plan and report findings.
Delegate Hodges, you haven't been in here, but what we've been doing on these is if the department says that they'll do something, then if you ask the chairman of that committee, such as Delegate Yancey, to write you a letter, and I'm sure he would, because we're going to ask him to, our posture then has typically been to lay the bill on the table, ask for that specific chairman to write a letter, ask them to do it, and they said they'll do it.
They said they'll do it, as long as we can get on to move forward with this.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we lay the bill on the table with the understanding of a chair letter.
Okay. Do you want a second?
Second.
Okay. Please cast your vote. Thank you. By a vote of.
Oh, man, it just came.
Okay.
Wow.
By a vote of 6-0, the measure's been laid on the table. Delegate Hodges, make sure you get up and Delegate Yancey. Okay.
Thank you.
Delegate Van Valkenburg. House Bill 2638.
Yes, well, innovation committee, and there are teachers and administrators.
But if we start establishing advisory committees within various professions that would then be able to weigh in on regulations that are pending rather than just go through the normal public access and public comment process, then we'd be creating advisory committees to do that, I think, throughout our code and in all of our professional areas. But when you have regulations in the septic field, then we have an advisory committee then for those folks who are in that business, because regulations will affect them. Kind of
sure, I would just clarify that it's not about pending regulations so much as it is regulations are in fact, how is it impacting the teacher working? And how is it impacting how you do your job? How do we make regulations still work while creating a better work environment? I'll just clarify that point. I understand your rhetoric.
Okay. Anyone here speak to this matter?
Absolutely can understand all of the current considerations that the committee has brought up and the VA does support. So.
Thank you. Okay, committee, what's your pleasure?
Second.
The motion seconded to report the measure. Please cast your vote. I have a vote of 2-4. The measure does not move forward. Thank you. Delegate Dial. HJ 679.
Good evening. We have a substitute.
We've got substitutes. All fair substitutes, yeah. Hey, substitutes of course.
Pastor's resolution 679 essentially touches upon the Virginia teacher shortage. We have a severe shortage and we need to look at every opportunity available to keep our teachers.
Well, let me stop you for a second. Is this yeah, I believe this is the JMARC study, you know.
Yes, this is the reason for initially we had.
Let me tell you what we've done today on every single JLARC study is, I believe the gentleman to my right is, of course, on JLARC, maybe the vice chairman, but what we have requested is that all JLARC studies are being laid on the table, and then we're asking by letter for JLARC to look and see on their priority list which ones they want to put so in the pecking order. So that's what we have done to all of them. So I believe that's going to need to be the posture of this one, too.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, may though, on the technical content of this, I would ask the question. Virginia already allows, in those areas that are a critical teacher shortage area, for a retired teacher after a 30-day separation from the previous school system to come back teaching in a full-time capacity and still draw retirement. So. Classic examples is the taxi cab driver.
four trained doctors to practice in our rural and underserved areas. And I just want to be clear on a couple things. These are individuals who are currently living in Virginia, and also we're not asking for any type of leeway in terms of the qualifications that they would have to meet in order to practice in the U.S. So they would still have to undergo the exact same rigorous, meet the rigorous training criteria and undergo the appropriate processes as U.S. trained doctors. Just trying to just peel back the onion in terms of why they're not. There's some other states that have looked at this issue, including looking at how doctors can serve their rural communities, particularly in Minnesota. And so I wanted us to be able to kind of start to delve into this conversation. And I did have conversations with both the Virginia Medical Society and the Health and Hospital Association to also support.
Anyone here to speak to this motion? Delegate Borop says that he would be glad to send a letter being the chairman of HWI. So, I'll say that, and I'll go back and see if y'all want to make a motion or not. Okay? Ready?
Mr. Chairman, that would lay on the table to understand, I'll work with the patron to communicate her wishes to the Department of Health Professions.
Well, okay. So there's a motion and a second to lay the bill on the table, and of course we have to understand it, and the chairman will send the letter. Please cast your vote. Yes, ma'am.
I heard it
ring early, but by a vote of 6-0, motion's laid on the table. Measure is Capodelli or I.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. See, we have Delegate LaRock. Yes, sir. You want to do HA 687 first? Or your choice.
Start out with a simple one.
Sure. Your choice.
HA 694, parent funding study resolution.
Okay.
Currently, their services are provided in some areas of the town by Virginia State Police. That program, the services funded through portion of Commonwealth's motor vehicle registrations, current funding level. All vehicle owners in the Commonwealth pay this fee. That flight program only serves some geographic regions in the Commonwealth, leaving other areas that people have private providers. Those areas, victims of accidents, others needing emergency care ambulance services, often find themselves receiving significant bills from private providers, which may not be covered by their health insurance. So as you can see from the proposed resolution, it requests availability and affordability of air emergency medical services throughout the Commonwealth and conducted the study. Virginia State Police would bring this specific resolution. Shall determine the current availability of air emergency medical services throughout the Commonwealth. To determine current costs associated with air emergency medical services throughout the Commonwealth. Would be costs to the Commonwealth and costs to the individual consumers. Compress up costs.
Mr. Chairman, just bring up several points on the matter. First of all, if this is going to go forward, it shouldn't go to state police because they don't have this data.
all air medical service vehicles come under Department of Health, even the state police choppers. The state police choppers operate candidly in competition with private air medical providers in the Richmond area. They operate exclusively in certain southern areas where there is no private air medical provider. And they began operation because there were none. One of the other challenges this brings is the state police chopper patients will never get a bill and cannot, because the chopper pilots are not certified commercial pilots, therefore cannot be billed as a commercial entity. But everywhere else, they're gonna be getting bills. This is an onion with a myriad of layers. I'm very sympathetic. I will say there was a study 2 years ago of stakeholders, and they came to no consensus on what should happen. If the intent of the resolution is to try and find out what it would cost for Virginia to implement a Maryland system, whereby in Maryland all air medical transport is done by state police, and taxpayers don't pay to the same extent, you know, it's a state-run system. I still think we need to go to Department of Health if it's going to get looked at, and this would be quite a heavy lift for them, I suspect, as well.
Yes, sir.
Anyone here to speak to this matter?
I would say, don't think they did him a favor, but that's a mess.
Okay. Committee, what's your pleasure?
I'm in the way.
Okay, there's a motion, a second, to lay the bill on the table. Please cast your vote. By a vote of 6-0, the matter is laid on the table. Yes, sir.
Yes, okay. Yeah. Okay. 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 Okay.
Chairman.
Delegate Tom.
Move that we pass the bill on that.
Is that debatable?
Yeah, yeah.
Chairman.
I'm gonna get a second on that. Okay, there's a second.
Mr. Chairman, I support the motion, not because I don't believe that any teacher who would abuse their position to do such a thing should be permitted to. I don't think they should be. And I, having done 32 years in classroom, in government, in history, where some of these topics come up, one of my happiest memories is having a student and ask me at the end of the year, Mr. Ware, what this is part of the public office, Mr. Ware, are you a Republican or a Democrat? And I said, what do you think? And he said, he thought for a pause and said, I think you're a Democrat. I took that as a compliment because he didn't know where I stood. And I, teachers who would misuse the authority and the opportunity to have in the classroom, I think it's something that we all should, I was going to say condemn. We, none of us should approve of that kind of thing. I don't think that this is the way to accomplish that. I don't think this would actually get us there. Moreover, it has one thing that I object to on a regular basis. It puts yet one more requirement in here, 3 hours annual continuing teacher education instruction. We have loaded up that statute. I remember talking to Tag Reese a few years ago, and he was amazed at the number of things that are there for a teacher. So for those reasons, the intent and the concern and the circumstances that you described, I think, are totally objectionable. I don't think this is the way to answer that. Yes, sir.
Okay, please cast your vote.
Yes,
sir.
Yes, sir.
I haven't heard any better alternative proposed with respect to the state of the delegate. It's very easy to strike a line from the resolution about teacher training. But if we don't do this, I think we are allowing the schools to compromise our democracy, which is a very, very big mistake to make.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. Okay, please cast your vote. The motion is to pass by indefinite. Motion carries by a vote of 7-0.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, committee.
Thanks, sir.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Look, on Delegate Torrey's measures, I made note, told the patron on her HGR 729 with a similar procedural issue as it is a study that was introduced after the deadline. So I don't think it's properly before us, but I did communicate with her that I would work with her off script to do a letter to try and address her concerns.
Thank you. So, committee HJ 729 isn't properly before us. I think y'all heard it. Delegate Rocks and Wolf right there.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Delegate Corey, I guess you have HJ